Good morning, everybody. This is Dave Toot. Sorry for the delay in getting started. We had no internet connection at the church this morning, so we can keep going, but it will be a service of the spoken word, which I guess we can live with that for a Sunday. And I thank everybody who's here on Zoom. I'm going to go ahead and switch this so that we're seeing just a few people at a time, and we'll ask Marcia Pratt to unmute herself and get us started.
O Lord of truth and peace, we plead for your presence among us and around us, this hour and every hour, in this city, this nation, every nation. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. In the absence of some other folks, I just want to welcome you all if you're watching through Facebook. And things are a little different this morning thanks to some wireless glitches, but we welcome those of you who are still connected. And I ask you now to join me as we pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our Old Testament reading for today comes from Psalm 36. Transgression speaks to the wicked deep in their hearts. There is no fear of God before their eyes, for they flatter themselves in their own eyes that their iniquity cannot be found out and hated. The words of their mouths are mischief and deceit. They have ceased to act wisely and do good. They plot mischief while on their beds. They are set on a way that is not good. They do not reject evil. Your steadfast love, O God, extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. Your judgments are like the great deep. You save humans and animals alike, O Lord. How precious is your steadfast love, O God. All people may take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light we see light. O, continue your steadfast love to those who know you, and your salvation to the upright of heart. Do not let the foot of the arrogant tread on me, or the hand of the wicked drive me away. There the evil doers lie prostrate. They are thrust down, unable to rise. Here ends the reading.
Today's New Testament reading comes from the book of Acts, chapter 9. It talks about the conversion of Saul. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice to say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias." "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priests to arrest all who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go, this man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings, and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord, Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized. And after taking some food, he regained his strength. This ends the reading.
Good morning again. I almost feel like I should whistle or hum or sing or something. But thank you for enduring what probably will be quite a lot of me speaking without the music in between. But nonetheless, we're gathered in the name of the Lord, and he is here. We thank him for that promise. Last time that I spoke with you from the book of Acts, we encountered Peter and John's healing of a lame man in chapters 3 and 4. But today we jump to Acts 9, which you just heard, Saul's journey to Damascus. That's leaping over an awful lot, though. So let me just give you the super quick list of the events that occur in those intervening chapters. Some of them probably familiar to you. Ananias and Sapphira conspired to lie about their generosity, a frightening incident where they fell dead. Peter and John were imprisoned a second time, but set free by an angel. Stephen was stoned following a fiery speech to the Sanhedrin. Philip takes the gospel to Samaria and Ethiopia. Simon the sorcerer comes to believe, but he doesn't understand. He wants to pay for the gift of laying on hands and giving the Holy Spirit. So that finally, though, that brings us to chapter 9. And that's where we are this morning. About 15 years ago or so, I made a list on a piece of paper, and I kept it in my Bible. It stayed there for several years. And everyone on that list, it was a list of names, everyone had zero interest in Jesus. In fact, they were people in my life who seemed perhaps the most unlikely to ever be a follower of Jesus. But I kept the list in my Bible as a reminder to pray for them. And in capital letters across the top of the list was my title, Saul to Paul List. God is a doer of some very unlikely things. No? Consider just how unlikely Saul would have been to receive the Apostle of the Year award, let's say. He was a zealous young standout among Pharisees who were Jesus' nonstop antagonists, opponents of the gospel. When Stephen, the first of the new believers to be martyred, was enduring the stoning, Saul was there, smugly approving, watching over the cloaks of the stone throwers. He was widely known as the persecutor in chief, having made it his goal to wipe out the early Christians. And this was no kind of bland, basic, investigate and arrest kind of enterprise. For Saul, it was a personal vendetta of sorts. It seems he evidenced a kind of a wild, seething with rage sort of fervor for this. The two main words Luke uses to describe Saul's zealotry are words most frequently used to describe a wild animal goring or tearing apart another animal or person. So the image that Luke is conjuring here in Acts is that of Saul devouring Christians. And what is more, in his later writings to Timothy and to the Galatians, Saul, then Paul, himself acknowledges the depth of that murderous anger that filled him and motivated him in his previous life. So this Saul was the most dangerous of fanatics, so perversely misguided as to embrace murderous ways. You know, at the I Hate Jesus the Most Olympics, he would have won the gold medal, hands down. And yet, as far from Jesus as he was, as hopeless of a case as one might assume, as dangerous a man as he was, as evil a sinner as he was, yet Jesus saved him. Sisters and brothers, do you believe that the Lord of heaven can turn the hopeless upside down? I don't just mean bringing good out of nothing, but bringing good out of its polar opposite. Do you believe that the depth of evil can be consumed by and redeemed by the love and power of God? There are so many Sauls in the world today, and so many Saul-like circumstances, so many Saul viruses, so many Saul violences. I will admit to you that I am grieving almost to the stage of hopelessness, the state of the church in America. Like you, I witnessed the chaos and violence of recent days, the mob descending on the Capitol, but that mob was bearing Jesus saves signs side by side with flags of stars and bars, racism, anti-Semitic logos, patches on clothing, a 15-foot gallows to execute their perceived enemies. I see the church screaming, "Stop the steal," falsehoods, rather than proclaiming the "He is risen" truth. I hear endless spouting about my rights this and my freedoms that, both of them accompanied by disdain for the safety of others. I see bitter attempts to legislate morality upon those yet to encounter redemption. It's a backwards law before grace kind of Pharisaism. I see a church concerned with reckoning others' sins while excusing its own lack of compassion. I see a church today, in short, that looks a lot more like Saul than Paul. We are traveling to Damascus with a misguided zealotry, sprinting away from Jesus rather than beside him. Should I despair? I wonder if sometimes when we pray, we fall a little short on believing that Jesus Christ is the kind of God who can accost the murderer on his way to harm others with a blazing light from the sky and an audible voice and a stroke of blindness. I wonder if we pray for things only in expectation that God may grant the tame or unsurprising lesser versions of our requests. We pray for big things only maybe for appearances or out of obligation, or perhaps kind of like playing the lottery. You know, exciting to think about the prospect, but no chance in Hades we'd actually win. If God did grant something rather impressive, would you sit in shock, blown away that God actually is in the business of life-changing works? What seems like a lost cause to you? What people or circumstances in your life? The estranged spouse or rebellious child? A medical struggle? A multi-year cloud of depression? What change are you convinced would literally require a blinding light from the heavens and an audible voice of the risen Christ? Or the question that's always simmering in the background when I gaze in despair at the Sauls all around: has the Lord turned me from Saul to Paul? I mean, insofar as he has done so, will I extend that same charity to others, mindful of how much I haven't deserved such mercy? And insofar as my transformation from Saul to Paul is barely underway, not anywhere close to finished, will I extend the same patience to others as I do to myself? Back in 2006, during George Bush the Younger's presidency, he outed with a memorable line when his choice for Secretary of State was questioned. I'm sure some of you remember it. "I'm the decider. I'm the decider." It went on to become a meme of viral proportion. "I'm the decider." Really? There's something worth noting about Saul's conversion that I think should shake up our sensibilities. So often we delude ourselves into thinking we are in control. You know, our choices determine our destiny. In matters of faith, we often envision our pursuit of the Lord, our seeking of Christ, as "I'm the decider." It's especially easy to do that if we can point back to a specific altar call moment. Some of us have those events. But sometimes, and I think at root, it's a bit more like Saul, just walking merrily along and then bam, accosted, blinding light, divine declaration, "You will be my witness." I don't mean necessarily that we have that exact same experience, but what I mean is the Lord's work that accomplishes it. Not, you know, "Paul, will you believe me? Pretty please, with a cherry on top." No, God's approach here is more like, "Dude, you're wrong. And guess what? You are going to take a new path." I think perhaps more than anyone else in the world, Paul understood that it is Christ who saves and not ourselves. Paul had done nothing to be redeemed. In fact, expressly the opposite, ravaging Christ's church. And he had made no intellectual journey, no search for Christ, no personal effort to find him. He was simply arrested by Christ, literally blinded by the capital L light. In the end, it was clear that Jesus chose Paul. Perfect righteousness chose, at that stage of the game, for Paul, near perfect evil, holy by grace. We would do well to see how, when we look back at our own journey, whether that's a slow turning or an altar call instant, we'd do well to look back and see and ponder honestly, truly, is that God's initiative reaching for us, calling us, turning us? Our repentance, our seeking, that's something to gaze upon with awe at how the Lord accomplished it. Not look back with satisfaction about the wise and meritorious decision we made, the path we've taken. No. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Kind of wonder if Paul wrote that. Supposedly it was a little later in history, but what an image. Was blind, but now I see. That restoration of sight is where I'm going to conclude this morning, the restoration of sight through the ministry of Ananias. Can you identify with the reluctant Ananias? God says, restore sight to Saul. And Ananias is thinking, Saul? Like that guy who would be pumped to throw me in prison, to have me flogged, to have me stoned to death? That guy who hates Christians? You know, we were shaking in our boots already when we heard he was coming to Damascus, and now you want me to A, search for him, and B, lay hands on him so that you can heal this lunatic serial killer? But in an ironic twist, God shows Ananias the light. He removes his blindness and gives him a no-option command. Verse 15, the Lord said, go, for Paul is my chosen instrument. Today, I proclaim to you good news, gospel hope, not of our own doing, but of the Lord's declaration. There is no one, no circumstance, no sin, no path, no choice, no stubbornness, no loss, no violence, no error, no darkness, no anything is ever beyond the compassion of Christ or his power to redeem. God can transform any Saul into his chosen Paul. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Amen and amen. There are so many who need our attention, our prayers, our love. So many instances of Saul that need to be resolved by the Lord's grace made into Paul. So come with me before the Lord as we pray, lifting brothers and sisters and trials and circumstances around us up to the Lord that he might heal and restore. Lord above, we pray for so many in our midst, knowing that as the healer, you are near to these broken hearts and broken bodies. We pray for Barbara, facing heart surgery on the 21st. For Anne, as she recovers from hip surgery. Ruth, recovering as well. Dwight, Bev, recovering from car accident injuries. For Dale, as he recuperates at home. Billy, at home as well, facing further procedures. Sylvia, recovering from a broken arm. Lord, we pray for so many dealing with the scourge of cancer. For Gary, Joyce, and Carla. For Dale and George's cousin, Dawn. For Nancy, who continues radiation treatments. We pray for Derek, who's struggling to turn his life around. For Cindy, a wife, mother, grandmother, hospitalized with COVID and in a coma, medically induced coma. We continue to pray for school administrators, educators, parents, students. We thank you for vaccinations that will end this pandemic. And we pray that there would be enough for all. We pray for protection from the violence of political extremists in this broken world. For protection in body, but also in mind, as we deal with the trauma of seeing these events unfold before us. We pray for a friend who has a mental illness, the friends and family who are caring for her, for those who are living with mental health issues, those who are addicted, for older members struggling with isolation. We pray for those in long-term care facilities, for their families who love them, for all who grieve, all suffering loss, facing abuse. We remember today our friends and family serving in the military. Thank them for their service. We pray for our church family, especially waiting for our new pastor, Dr. Karen Borchert. We pray she would arrive in time for Easter. What a symbolic and beautiful resurrection. We pray that we would be able to seek and find ways to stay connected with each other and with the Lord. We pray that we would show the world, what would Jesus do? All this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And with boldness and joy, we proclaim the statement of faith. We believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and proclaim him Lord and Savior of the world. If you have not yet assembled elements for the communion service, you may take a moment here and step away from the screen and get what you will use for the bread and the cup. Let us begin by taking a few moments of silence to prepare our hearts before the Lord. Amen. Participating in this holy meal is both a joyful privilege and a sobering mandate. We're called not to eat and drink of it lightly or hypocritically. If you harbor unconfessed sin in your life, animosity against a neighbor, or for any other reason feel distracted in your approach to this table, it is an honorable decision to refrain for a time. Yet to all who humbly confess and repent of their sin, whosoever will, by God's grace, affirm today, or for the first time in ages, the thousandth time, the life-changing grace of Christ's death and the sanctifying freedom of his bodily resurrection. Receive with new hope his sacrifice for sin, and with renewed anticipation his gift of eternal life. In the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 26, we read, "While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, 'Take and eat. This is my body.' Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine now until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.'" Let us pray. O Lord, bless now these elements. Mark these symbols of grace as sacred food, and in some way, mysteriously and wonderfully beyond our comprehension, be present in this sacrament. Nourish us to love and serve and joyfully proclaim you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The body of our Lord broken for you, eat with thanksgiving. And the blood of our Lord shed for you, drink with gratitude. Amen. Amen. Would you receive the benediction? The words of the Damascus Road changed Apostle Paul. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. May you have a peaceful Sabbath. Amen.
Thank you to David for this wonderful service this morning. I apologize to George and Nancy Johnson, who I didn't see in the waiting room. George, if you can hear me now, would you like to do announcements? While we're waiting, oh, there he is. Sorry, George.
Yes, I can do announcements.
Sorry, George, you're all broken up. Just barely getting your video stream. I know we need to announce that there's a meeting tomorrow night for the general board. Is that correct? I think people on general board, is that, looks like George is moving to a better internet location as well. Anybody who's on a general board, what time is the meeting? Is it 7 tomorrow night?
I think they're muted.
Yeah. Says 6.
It says 6? Okay. All right. Thanks. I couldn't remember. How you doing, George? You got better connection now? While we're, whoops, did we lose him completely? And I don't know, how about if other folks unmute yourselves and give us any announcements you may have, birthdays that we're missing this week. Nobody.
Yes, happy anniversary to Dave and Kim.
Oh, that's right. I knew that on Tuesday.
That's good. That's very good.
On Tuesday. Any other announcements that we need for the week? Okay, I'm going to end the Facebook Live. Thank you for our friends and who have been watching on Facebook.